whined on. I don't know why.
Okay, may I please have your full name?
Mary Montgomery Terryberry. And that's why I'm called Monty, is because Montgomery was my maiden name.
Was your maiden name. Can you tell us, how did you come to White Lake and Sylvan Beach?
Well, I came to Sylvan Beach when I was in college, visiting the Clays. But I went to camp north of the channel when I was 11. The campfire camp was north of the channel, so I was up there for 3 summers. So I'm in this area a long time.
Okay, what was the campfire camp? Was that Girl Scouts?
Campfire is not Girl Scouts.
Okay, I don't know.
No, Camp Kiwano it was. Okay. Was the name of it. But campfire is a competitor of Girl Scouts.
Oh, okay. Okay. So you were at the camp your first few years. How did you find Sylvan Beach? How did you come to Sylvan Beach?
The Clays invited me up as a guest. And then 1 year, Mr. Clay was president of the association, and he said, how would you like to come up and do something for the children this summer? And I said, he said, and be our guest at the cottage. So I came for the summer and did something for the children. That was my job description.
Something for the children.
Yeah. That's all I ever had.
What did you do? Did you lifeguard?
No, that was out of my territory. No, I taught crafts and dancing, and we put on a plays every 3 weeks with different age groups. And I guess we had volleyball games and softball and that sort of thing.
Go ahead.
I can't remember what else we did.
How many years did you do this?
I just did that 1 year.
1 year.
But I didn't know anything about what you'd had before. And about the 1st of August, Mrs. Ross said, when are you going to have the jinx? And I said, what's the jinx? And she said, why, it's our usual annual play that we have every year. And you have to have the jinx. So this was a little sudden, but somehow I knew Joe and Art Sidoni and Jack DeFraga, who lived with them. And the three of them said, we'll help you. So they did all the backstage work and the everything that I knew didn't know anything about, and we did a jinx. And I always remember Art said, don't be surprised if I think it needs a little pepping up, something unusual happens. So suddenly Art came swinging out from the top on a rope by the legs, and everybody was screaming and yelling. And I thought this was just what he had planned, and I only found out a couple of years ago that he had planned to do it, but he hadn't planned to be caught in the rope, and he didn't plan to do it the way he did it.
Oh, my God.
So I thought that was sort of exciting.
Oh, that's funny.
Isn't that funny?
That is right. A typical jinx stunt.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can you tell me what year that jinx was?
Yeah, it was in 1934.
Now that we've mentioned a couple things that I was going to ask you, and I might as well, now that we've talked about them, deal with them. Can you tell me something? Do you remember Joe Sidoni very well? Do you have any memories of him?
Well, mainly his help with the jinx, and he and Art were very nice to help me out. I was completely flabbergasted.
Because you had never even seen the jinx.
I'd never been here. I didn't know what she was talking about.
Oh my God.
But she said, you know, Betsy dances.
So that was to be in the jinx. Mm-hmm. Was this Joe Sidoni Jr.?
Mm-hmm.
What you're talking about? Okay, mm-hmm. Joe and Art. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did you ever meet the father?
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. What did you think of him?
Well, he was very nice, very kind. They had some connection with the theater in Whitehall. I guess, I don't know whether they ran all the backstage. I guess Art played the piano for some of the movies, did he?
I think he did, yes he did.
I didn't know that till recently, but they were having a show that fall, which they invited me to try out for, and I was in it, called 20 Mile Limit or something. Carl, somebody, had written it, directed it, and the Sidonis were doing all the backstage work. And Mr. Sidoni was there. I don't know what his official function was.
Did you ever see him do any of his, or say anything of his psychic powers? Did you ever see any of that manifested?
No.
Okay. Do you remember having heard about something?
Yeah.
That may have happened?
Well, I haven't heard of any specific ones, but I knew that he had quite a reputation.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That was the beginning of many years that you were with the Jinx. And can you tell us about those many years that you were with the Jinx? You were in charge of the...
Well, that we were never up here all summer until we rented next door. But you see, I was at the clay cottage when it was up on the hill and it burned to the ground. That's where the Denison's cottage is now. And then when it burned down, and they built this down here, Mr. Clay, when he was president, had some surveying done, and they discovered there were three lots down here that they didn't know belonged to Sylvan Beach. So he took this one, and the Hodsons were just going to build, and they bought this, and the Posts bought the next one. So that's how come there's three cottages of a slightly newer era.
Probably darn, they didn't even know that they had the lots.
Mm-hmm. Not till they surveyed.
Oh, jeez. That is something. Your years with the Jinx, what was your job with the Jinx? You were in charge, you were the chairman of the social...
The first year I was everything.
Yeah, you did everything.
Except,
everything.
But then after we came up and rented, we were never here in July, in August, until we bought this. And that was in 1945. So there was a gap, of course, a long time. But we were soon put in charge of all the children's activities. And we hired the people who ran the Jinx, and Sally Denison was our first one, and she had never put on a show, and I said, oh, Sally, I'll help you with that. So she and I really did it together. And ever after that, for a long, long time, I helped with something. Ended up doing the makeup, which is so much fun when the little kids come and they've never had any lipstick, you know, and they all go, you know, and you say smile.
Yeah.
You have to have your lips firm, and they make them so pretty and so sloppy that you can't get the lipstick on. But they love the makeup, and I thought that was the most fun of all.
Was doing that.
Well, it was something that was fun because you saw all the little children.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you put that on for many years, because I remember as a child you used to put
it on.
Oh
yeah, that was, yeah,
yes.
I did it for a long time.
For how many, many, many years?
I don't know.
And then your daughters too were involved in the Jinx.
Yeah, Joey was chairman of the Jinx one year, and then she did the choreography for several years after that.
What was the theme of the Jinx she did? I remember that Jinx, I remember her doing it, but I...
As it is a small
world.
I can tell you, I have a program there. But.
Okay, yeah. And Joey went into the Peace Corps, didn't she?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And was in there for several years.
Well, it's always a 2-year stint. You can sign up again, but she was married on a Friday, and she and her husband reported to the Peace Corps on Sunday. That was their honeymoon, where they got up at 7 in the morning and had classes till 9 at night for 2 months, 3 months, I guess. And then they were in Tunisia for a couple of years.
Wow.
So,
and
That was very gracious, though, to do that. It was very neat that your daughter would do that.
Oh, she was always, had somebody that she was helping do this or helping to, you know, come
she
forward.
She is very special that way.
She is very special.
Very kind, good soul, always helping. Right. And you have another daughter, too, don't you?
Oh, I think you know that. Yes. Marianne.
Marianne
Byam.
To George Byam.
Yeah.
And, I think since we're on that, can you tell us something about your family business, your husband's business, his name and his business?
Yeah, his name is Arthur Parker Terryberry, and his father founded the Terryberry Company in the early 20s, I think, and Terry went to work for them right out of school, and he's still... has his office there and goes down every day, but George is really running the business at this point.
And that's George Byam.
George Byam.
And I heard he's done a really fantastic job.
Yes, he has. Yes.
Matter of fact, I saw him on TV a year or two ago.
Did you? Yeah. We saw that.
The company, but I understand he's done a fantastic job.
And Mike, their older son, who just graduated from Hope College in June or May, is now working for Terryberry Company out in Kansas City as his headquarters.
Oh, wow. Is he selling? Or?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
Great. So that's another member of the family.
Dude. Yeah.
That's wonderful. Wonderful. Can you tell us something about the Sylvan Beach Church? You've been deeply involved in the Sylvan Beach Church.
Well,
how long have you been involved, and what is your capacity?
My capacity, I guess, purchasing agent. when the Wob Club burned down, then, well, I guess you want to start before that. When Harold Mulder passed away, they needed a pianist, and I'm not a pianist, and I never was, but I said I would help them out till they found somebody. And he passed away in 62. And I didn't start playing, I think, every week for maybe for one summer because I thought, you know, they'd find a better pianist. And they didn't. And my mother said, "You're not going to play the piano, are you?" Because I'm a singer and I don't play the piano. She's a church organist and she knows what she should be like. But I went to church one Sunday and I decided, yes, I was a pianist because I forget who was playing, somebody that really could hardly read the notes. So I started and I said I'd do it till they found somebody. But last year I decided it was time to retire. So I retired.
So for how many years did you play the piano?
Well, from about 63 maybe until...
About 30 years?
Yeah, almost. About 29.
Mm-hmm. Going back for a second, how did you and Parker meet?
Oh, well, he has to tell you that.
Oh, he has to tell you that story, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. You've also always are seen playing tennis. Can you tell us who, in your opinion, have been some of the very good tennis players that have played at Sylvan Beach, female and male?
Well, I don't know. Terry plays the very good ones. I play the others. I'd always played tennis, and when we went on our honeymoon, I took my racket, and he did, and he had never seen me play, and I think he was ready to turn me in when he saw me because he had been on the tennis team in high school and college, and I was self-taught and played all the wrong ways. So he took my game apart for about 10 years. I really could hardly play at all because every time the ball would come, I didn't know which way to do it, the old way or the new way. But it takes you really have to learn the right way at first, yeah. Or you waste a lot of time.
So you finally had to unlearn that?
I had to unlearn what I had done and start over.
Oh, boy.
But my backhand, fortunately, I happened to learn right, but the forehand I had a terrible time with. But I used to play with Betty Casperi and
okay.
Who else did we play with? I can't remember. It was back so far. We used to play with John and Grace Nuveen years ago, and Joe and John McFadden. You asked about the good tennis players. I don't know that these all qualify. I played with Jerry Ford one time when Betty was, you know, was, what was his name? Her mother was a widow, and she married Mr.
Godwin.
Godwin, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I had known Betty for a long time, and so I remember playing with him one time, and he fell, which, you know, he had a bum knee, and his knee was bleeding, but he got right up and played, and I always hated the fact that they laughed at him when he was having problems with his knee when he was president, because I know that he really had problems with his knee.
My God.
His football playing.
When I was at on Sylvan Beach when you were playing tennis with him, how many times did you play with him?
Probably not. He wasn't here very often, and nor for very long. I think he was running for his first year in the... he and Betty were married the year that he was elected to Congress the first time, and he was up here just maybe two or three times then. And Mrs. Godwin died, and there was another Mrs. Godwin after that.
See,
the first Mrs. Godwin was killed in an automobile accident in Mexico. And I think that was the summer I was running the Jinx for Mr. Clay. It was a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And so he married Mrs. Bloomer, Betty's mother, and then she died, and he married Mrs. What was her name? I should know. I know her as Mrs. Godwin, but she's passed away now. They're all gone.
Yeah. No problem. Do you have any funny stories that you could think of on the tennis court? Some of the funnier things or things that you remember that were funny that happened to you playing tennis or you saw down at the tennis courts?
Oh, well, tennis is a lot of fun, but it's not funny. Mine might have been, but I don't think so, no.
No, there wasn't anything ever.
We had more of a funny experience when we went sailing the first time that Terry and I were visiting. We were visiting the Clays, and John Clay, do you remember John Clay?
Yes.
Took us sailing, and I'd been a few times with Rachel, but John said to Terry, who was a wonderful swimmer, he used to be the lifeguard at camp and gave Red Cross examinations and things, so he was a good swimmer. I wasn't, so I stayed on the high side of the boat, and John said, Terry, you sit on the low side. So he did, and it kept getting lower and lower, and he kept getting wetter and wetter, and pretty soon we went over. He didn't tell him to get up, and he didn't think he was supposed to get up, so we tipped over, and I don't know that Terry has been very keen about sailing ever since.
It's a bit of a story. What type of boat was that, do you remember?
I think it was a seaboat.
A seaboat.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's good.
Because I used to hear all the sailing news being at their house that summer because Mr. Clay had an e-boat with two or three other men, Mr. Godwin and Mr. Spear, I think. You remember the Spears mm-hmm. had the cottage up there? And I don't know who else. They were the only ones I knew. And George had a seaboat. And they'd race on the Saturdays, and then Saturday night they'd rehash all of the races, you know. And I came around this buoy, and I didn't know what they were talking about. I didn't know anything about sailing. All I knew was sit on the high side.
Yeah, you learned that, in Parker.
Right.
Too the hard way.
Yeah.
Oh God. When you were here in the 30s, who were your peers? The people that you hung around with and played with and did
in the 30s?
Yeah.
Well, you see, I was busy.
Yeah, that's true.
I didn't really know the people. I knew the kids because they were the ones I worked with. I remember the first play we put on was Cinderella, and I wrote it because I couldn't find a script. And Barb Wagner was Cinderella. She was the cutest little six-year-old you've ever seen.
I've heard that.
She was seven. I don't remember, but she was just a darling little girl with blonde curls.
Wow. As time went on, who became your peers when you finally came up here to live?
Well, my peers, I don't know. We played tennis with anyone who would play, and mostly we had a lot of older friends because Terry wasn't in the Army. He had a bad shoulder, and he wouldn't like this in your... You can skip that.
Sounds good. This is just the type of... Okay, 1, 3, 2, 1.
The summer we bought the cottage was 1945, and of course that's the summer the war ended. And I remember Sammy Post being sent from cottage to cottage. Nobody had phones, you know, to tell us the war was over. And that they were going to have a bonfire down in where the WAB Club is now. And Bill Hodson had organized it. And we had all kinds of, we had a huge bonfire, you know, a tree size bonfire. And sang songs and sort of, I forget what else, but it was very exciting.
Oh, it must have been.
But that was the end of the war, and that was the summer we had this for the first time. So.
Okay, so that was VJ Day then, probably. That
right.
was August of 1945, yeah. That's exciting. Everybody was knocking on the doors, and you all went down to the beach and probably sang.
Not the beach, down at the WAB Club.
Down at the WAB Club.
Yeah.
We had a big fire outside there.
Yeah.
Sang a lot of great songs, and George and Cole,
You know, Bill was so great at getting things like that organized.
He was a great man.
He really was.
A real loss.
Very, very wonderful man. And of course, he built this cottage. Didn't you know that?
Yeah.
Well, the first year we came up to visit the Clays, they had just built this cottage, and Bill was building this cottage. And of course, we didn't know him. But then when we came up and rented, which was probably a summer or two later, we got to know them, and they were still building it, because they did it themselves, a lot of it. And Bill was chairman of the grounds committee. I think this is interesting, because a lot of people wanted to know, I'll tell you later what they wanted to know. But we were very good friends by this time, because we'd been there for three different summers, parts of it, and Bill was chairman of the grounds, and we decided it was time we'd like to buy a cottage. And there was only one cottage for sale, and it was the Shipman Cottage. So he took us up to see it, and it was old, and nobody had been living in it. He had been using it as a fishing place. He'd bring cronies up, and they'd go fishing, and there were mice running around on the rafters, and it didn't look like what I had in mind. So we went home, and because we had just rented it for July, and we got home, we were home a week or so, and we said, you know, that cottage can't be as bad as we remember it. So we came back up, and Bill took us to see it again, and it was just exactly as bad as we remembered it. Everything was just as it had been. So we were sitting down in Bill's car in the parking lot, about to go back to Grand Rapids, and I said, Bill, the trouble is, we'd like a cottage like yours. And he said, how about mine? And I said, sold. He said, well, I'd have to talk to the family. And he said, you know, you don't have a kitchen. It was there, but there were no amenities. There was an ice box and a wood stove and no cupboards to speak of. It did have running water. But anyway, he said, you know, we're just about finished building that cottage, and I need a project for Bill and for the girls, too. Do you remember Bill Hodson?
Yes.
And I'd like a project for him. And maybe I should buy the other old cottage, and it would give us a project. and we're really outgrowing this, which he really was, because they had loads of company, and they had four children, and there are, you probably haven't seen it, but we have three small bedrooms that are double-deck bunks. The closet's about this wide, and a master bedroom. He said, you could put Joey in the one next to you and Marianne in the next one, and you could have the other one for the maid's room. Imagine remembering we did have a maid in those days.
Yeah, back then, yeah.
So we said, fine. He said, I'll buy it because I'm already a member of the association, and then we'll decide which one we keep. This was in during the war, and you could only spend $100 a year on remodeling in those days during the war.
Rationing type of thing.
It was rationed. But he could get lumber through Mr. Warfield, who was in the lumber business, and $100 worth of good lumber at a friendly rate, and four kids to work on it, he could do a lot more than we could.
Yeah.
So we made the deal, and we, all winter, we kept our fingers crossed. I didn't buy anything for the cottage. I didn't know which cottage it was going to be. All I bought was the watercolor that's above our couch. And we came up Memorial weekend, and he said, well, we've decided to take the Shipman Cottage. We were absolutely flabbergasted, because
the mouth's for me.
Yeah. And we had visited their house a couple times. They had just moved to Kenilworth. And Bill said, or Bob said, she had found a note on K.I. or Margot's, I guess it was on Margot's dresser, saying, somebody has made a terrible mistake. But that's how we got the cottage. But that summer, people said, how'd you get it away from him? And we felt sort of guilty, because we hadn't gotten it away from him. We just
asked him in the parking lot.
But just, he said, how would you like to buy ours? And for 5 years or more, every time we wanted to move a plant or change a color or do anything, we'd say, Bill, is it all right? We sort of felt as though it was still his. But we've loved this cottage. We think it's just darling, and Bill designed it, and it's very special to us.
It's a beautiful place. And that was young Bill Hodgson, too, helped build it.
Those girls, you know, they can lay a floor or panel a room or roof, put a roof on or do anything. Nancy and Margo and K.I., as well as Bill.
Bill, yeah. Bill was a tremendous loss also.
I know it.
Always a considerate, kind man.
Yeah.
Always inquiring about how you were, and just a real...
They are very special people.
Yes, they are.
All of them.
Yes. That's a fascinating story. I had never heard of that.
Well, it's very true, and absolutely word for word, because I've never forgotten the words.
Do you have any memories of the... war years up here, from the point of view, I know that you didn't buy the place till the last year of the war. Mm-hmm. Do you remember anything about rationing or food stamps or any stories?
I don't remember much about food stamps, but I know that there was a grocery, you know, that was down on the dock.
The arcade.
And it was on the arcade, yeah. And it was connected with one in town, which later became Leonard and Edna's. And I think maybe Edna just... and Leonard had the one down there. I'm not sure, because I didn't know them.
Yeah, it was originally Kearns, I think.
But they would send in an order, and then the grocery in town would bring it out, and it would be distributed, I guess, through the one on the dock. And that was, I guess, the beginning of Leonard and Edna. Edna would know all about that.
So you don't have any really memories of anything with food stamps or... gas rationing or anything?
Well, there was gas rationing, but we didn't go to town much,
okay.
If ever.
Did you have any problem going back and forth trying to get gas ever?
No.
Not when you came up here. This question's kind of a
I don't think you ought to put that in. Yeah.
No problem.
I forgot. I was on tape.
Don't worry.
Four,
okay. Okay, we're back on now. You were talking about some of the people that were there, Barb Wagner, Nancy Wagner, or Van Deventer. Who else would have been down there with you?
I don't remember. I remember the third Mrs. Godwin's daughter was a very, but I can't think of her name. She had the lead in one of the shows. Oh, Mim Bartlett Barr was in one of the plays. I remember the play too.
What play was it?
Maybe I don't remember the name. I just remember what it was about.
The play itself. Mm-hmm. Okay. During your years with the Jinx, can you remember what you call some of the funniest skits or different events during the Jinx or funniest Jinxes that you can remember?
Well, you know, what was the man's name that really started the Jinx?
Frank Adams.
Frank Adams. The one that Sally and I did, Joey was about 4, I think, and Marianne was 8, and Joey was going to dancing school, and she knew this little Mickey Mouse routine. And you probably don't remember this, but she taught it to Marianne, Marianne was, of course, a little old for it, but she thought it was fun. And at some of the picnics, Terry and Marianne and Joey would do this thing, so they made them do it in the Jinx. And Terry said, "I'm not going to do that silly thing in the Jinx," but he was persuaded to do it. And Frank Adams said, "That's the best act of all because it." And Terry was, you know, really an adult doing a child's thing, and Marianne was on the verge of thinking that it was a little beneath her, and Joey was just in the midst of it, and that was why he thought it was good. And I have pictures of that. It's,
oh, wow.
It's cute.
I'll have to, let a picture.
About Mickey.
And Joey, I could see her diving right into it. She was enthusiastic about everything she did.
She loved shows. She does a lot of choreography, or has done at the show, at the school where she teaches. She teaches, you know, down in Maryland. And her daughter's been in all kinds of things and is going to be up with people next year, they say.
Oh, wonderful.
Not this year, she's a senior in college, but then after she graduates. And Joey, do you want to know something about Joey?
Yeah, I was going to ask you, what does she teach? No.
She teaches English, and of course I'm her mother, so you can skip as much of this as you want to, but when they came back from the Peace Corps, they had been recruited, she and her husband, to teach in the inner city because they knew the Peace Corps people were committed. And so for 3 years they taught in Washington in the inner city. And then, and Joey got her master's degree from Howard University, which is that, you know. Anyway, then they moved out to the country, and when Kessler was born the next year, and then she wrote a book on teaching English because she was so horrified that the children in the local high school were graduating from high school with second grade reading levels. And so she trained 25 tutors and kept track of them and set them up with people that needed tutoring and got them to tutor these people to bring them up to standard, and she's still doing that. But also, when Kessler started school, she had given a seminar at the University of Maryland, and one of the superintendents who had been there wrote to the Middletown superintendent, which is their district, and said, "If you don't hire that girl, you're crazy. The best seminar I ever went to." Well, that I'm her mother.
No, I wanted to
But anyway, they had wanted to hire her, and when Kester started school, she did accept a half part-time job, which soon developed into full-time. She's still there, and Kester was graduating from college. And this fall, she's been invited to go to China with a group of 30 other English teachers from the United States on a what the Chinese can teach the English teachers about teaching English, I don't know, but this is organized by the University of, or by Michigan State University, and she's going. So they just got back from Indonesia because they got back Monday night.
Which is where she was in the Peace Corps.
No, she was in Tunisia.
Tunisia.
Tunisia is in Africa.
Africa, right.
Indonesia is in Asia, over near Korea and between Korea and India. It's an archipelago of islands. I didn't know that till recently.
I can remember there was a Sukarno used to rule.
That's right.
Yeah, I remember when Sukarno 1 and 2.
It's so many islands that it's as far from one end of their domain to the other as it is across the United States. But of course, more water than land, but the distance is that great. But they had a student from Indonesia that was an exchange student about 3 or 4 years ago, and they were very fond of him, and they were invited over to visit his family. And his father's in the government. He's head of the population and environment in Indonesia, and he showed them everything they needed to see, I guess, personally. And they stayed in his, he had two homes, one that's given to him as his job and one that they had just built, and they were sort of half and half. Yeah. There was plenty of room.
Oh, that's wild. That's something. Does Joey come up here at all anymore?
She was here in just the week before they went to Indonesia for just a weekend.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think I've seen Joey in 30 years, probably.
No, probably.
Tell her hi for me, would you?
Yeah,
she
I will.
She was always sweet to me when I was young. Very kind.
Well, you did a lot with the Jinx yourself. You know what went on down at the Jinx.
Yeah, it was many years. But I remember Joey was so good. I do remember her Jinx very well. I remember she was just, she'd bring the best out in you. She was so supportive, and so she'd build you up and not tear you down.
Well, she's that way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, certainly is. During the years from 34, when you were at the WAP Club and you were doing all those things that you worked there until you bought this place, how many years did you spend here from 34? I mean, what years were you here?
Well, we were just next door,
renting,
in July.
Okay, for all, most of the
No, year? Just for 3 years.
Okay, just for 3 years.
That'd be the 3 years before we bought, 42, 43, and 44.
Okay, so those were the war years. In 34, of course, Prohibition had just come to an end at that point in time. Do you remember when Prohibition was on? Do you remember any stories about Prohibition or anything going on around here?
No, because it was over when I came up that year.
Okay.
Our family never drank, so I had very little connection with Prohibition. Except that I had an aunt who went to Washington during the First World War when they needed people to work, and she invited my grandmother and father, and they took me with them to go down and spend some time one summer. And we stayed in the man's, it was a condominium, I'd never heard of it at that time. I said, how could anybody own a place up in the, you know, in the air that you don't have any ground or anything?
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
I know it. It was right across from Rock Creek Park. And but he owned this, and she was a friend of his, and so we stayed in his condominium. That was my most interesting, not Mr. Volstead, but I can't think what his name was.
Oh, wow.
It was somebody that had a big connection
with the Volstead Act.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be darned. That's funny you mentioned Rock Creek Park. I stayed in Rock Creek Park years ago on first trip to D.C. as a kid.
Yeah.
I remember there was a battle actually fought near there, right?
I suppose, yeah.
The South Gap.
Mainly I remember that I used to wander around. My aunt worked during the daytime, and my grandmother became ill, and so we had to stay an extra week or two, so I was there quite a while. And I went over in the park, and they offered to let me ride the ostrich. I declined, finally. I was tempted. I've tried everything.
The ostrich, to me, would be real stable, you know. Can you tell me why, when you bought this cottage and your kids were here, what was a normal day for you at night?
Is there a normal day?
Yeah.
Well, you go to the beach, play tennis.
Play tennis.
And that's...
Just come home and cook and...
Or cook outside and eat outside. We ate out a lot. I mean, outdoors.
Outdoors. Mm-hmm. Did you have any certain games you played or anything?
Oh, did we? I don't remember. Oh, potlucks was mainly what we had. The Mulders, through the Hodsons, we met the Mulders, and they were our very, very close friends, Mulders and Hodsons. And Myrtle came over one day, and of course there were no phones. She'd come over, because Harold would go to work in Muskegon, and so she'd be up early, and we'd be just having breakfast, and she'd walk in, and she'd have a cup of coffee with us, and she'd, let's have a potluck tonight. I still remember Harold saying, oh boy, potlucks every night. So I think that's what we did.
But they have potlucks, which is a nice thing to do, which is an easy, fun thing to do.
Canasta came in. That was the game. Joey was five. The summer canasta came in. And it came in with a bang. We learned it one afternoon, and Myrtle said, that's a neat game. So we had to all get together that night and teach it to Terry and Harold. And the Martins were renting next door. John Martin, they were from Grand Rapids, and they had just come back recently one of the judges in the Nuremberg trials after the war. And they had four children, and their youngest, they had two daughters, and they were a little older than Joey and Marianne, but not much. And we would come into the living room when we got up in the morning, and these four girls would be there playing canasta. Joey couldn't count. She knew how. Have you ever played it?
No, not really.
Well, you had to have 15 to meld, I think. I haven't played for a long time, but for about 20 years we played canasta. We never played bridge or anything like that, because canasta just took over. And she knew if she had a joker, she could meld. I guess it was a joker. But then she'd have to ask somebody else to count to see how much she had for the next thing. And I always remember her saying, what do I have basically?
Basically, yeah.
That's what you had. You had to have basically. Much to get in and out. But it tickled me because it was such a sort of grown-up word at five.
How many points do I have basically? That's good. Do you remember any romances at Sylvan Beach that were classic to you?
Well, to us, I don't know. We went to Dick what's her name's wedding? Dennis and Dick and what's her first name?
I forget her name.
I know it, but I can't think of it.
Yeah.
They were married over in Kenilworth. Bill did the flowers. I remember he had geraniums, the kind that droop, that climbing. I mean, they're not geranium plants, but they are plants, but I mean, they're not the standard kind. They're drooping. And he did the flowers and he did the wedding. Oh, and there's a hummingbird. Oops. See him?
Well, there's one just right out back there, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's on the phone.
Yeah, we have a feeder back there.
I love those.
Yeah, they're cute, aren't they?
They are great.
But we went to their wedding and we stayed with the Bogarts. And I remember the Bogarts were very good friends too, because, you know, Marianne and Jens were very good friends. And Mary Lou was Joey's age. And Betsy, of course, was, we always thought was just a little girl, and she was reading. They thought she looked so precocious because she was reading, but she was in third grade, but it looked like about a kindergartner. But when we walked in the room, in the living room, the first time we'd ever been there, they did handsprings and cartwheels over through the living room.
Oh my God.
They were all very, they had a mat under the piano that they got out and did exercises, or I mean, not exercises, just it was fun, of course.
It was a fun thing to do.
Yeah.
That's a fascinating
story. They were little.
And George Bogart was a fantastic man.
He was a great guy.
Huh? He was just another.
And
one.
Louise, too. She, yeah. Her sense of humor is wonderful.
Yeah, it is. It is.
Since you've been here, what's the biggest change in Sylvan Beach that you've seen? Socially or what, whatever. What are the biggest changes?
Telephones.
Telephones?
Well, it makes a difference. We used to walk over to people's houses a lot. And now you telephone and they're not there, or if they are, you do your business and you're not in other people's homes as much, I think.
Do you consider that good or bad?
Well, it's more convenient, but I think you don't maybe get to know people as well.
Wow, that's a very good insight, and I like that because that makes good sense.
Mm-hmm.
So the more technical we've gotten, we've actually lost the ability to be personal in many ways.
Yeah, I think so.
That's a good point. What are some of the other social changes you've seen at Sylvan Beach? Is there more partying now? Is there more drinking? Less partying? Less drinking?
I don't know, because I never drank and I never was aware of who did or didn't. We'd come home from a party occasionally and Terry'd say, boy, he really was three sheets to the wind. I said, he was? Because I never realized it.
Yeah. You weren't looking for
it. I wasn't looking for it and I didn't see it. So.
Well, that's kind of a funny insight, too, that you really didn't even notice that the person was doing anything.
Well, I might, if it was, you know,
bad,
very bad, but I don't know. Never occurs to me to look for that.
Okay, that's very good. That's, are there more parties, do you think, now?
I don't know. There aren't as many potlucks. We had a lot of parties. You see, that group was quite extensive, but it was, as Hodgson said, there was the Josephsons, who were older than the Hodgsons, another 10 years or so. And so that group is just all gone. And we had a lot of parties. But that was the group, and the younger group, which probably we should have been in, came back from the war and they had their other, I don't think we were ever really part of it.
Yeah, because they probably had their own little thing in the room with the war as a common background.
So that was different, but we had a wonderful time. We miss all those people, especially the Bogarts and the Hodgsons and the Mulders.
Yeah, all great families, all great people.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's so many left like you, so that's good. What are some of the most notable characters that you ever down in Sylvan Beach or around the lake?
Did you ever know Clyde Bedell?
No.
The Bedells had, it used to be the Runyon Cottage, and then the Bedells had it, and then that was the one that the Rices had.
Okay.
Still have, only it was, you know, before they moved it.
Okay.
Clyde Bedell put in the funicular, and it was a gasoline engine, and the brakes worked from the top, and you'd go down, you'd get in, and you know how it always jerks as you start down, so you're grabbing it, and it would go, it went by its own weight as fast as you could go, and just as you get at the bottom, he'd put the brake on at the top, and it would come up like an elevator does, you know, under you. It was nothing like Kelly's very controlled thing. This was like the shoot the shoots.
Well, he had to visually guess with the brakes, too.
Yeah.
It was just,
yeah. Wow, that was exciting.
And he was a real character. Huh?
Oh, yes. He told some wonderful stories, some that I still tell that I think are wonderful.
Well, can you tell us a couple of them?
Well, do you really want it?
Yeah, I do.
I can tell you one. Oh, I haven't told it for a long time. Giuseppe and Giovanni met in New York. They hadn't seen each other for a long time, and when Giuseppe said, "Oh, and Giovanni, how is everything? Everything is terrible. I'm going back to the old country." "Well," he said, "and why are you going back to the old country?" "I don't like it here. Nothing is any good. I want to go back to the old country." "Oh, Giuseppe, where but in the United States of America could this happen? You come out of your work at night, you walk along the street, and the boss, he come along, he say, 'You look tired. Let me give you a ride home.' So, don't care if you do, get in his car. You drive along in this lovely limousine, and he say, 'You look hungry. Let's have a good dinner.' So, don't care if you do, go in, you have a good dinner. And afterward he say, 'Let's go back to my house and hear some nice music.' So, don't care if you do. So you go back to his house. It's a lovely house. You have a lovely evening of good music. And it gets late and you say, 'Oh, I must go home.' He says, 'It's late. Why not you stay here?' So, don't mind if you do. So you stay, and in the morning you have a lovely breakfast, and he drive you back to your work. Where but in the United States of America could that happen?" "Well, I don't know, Giovanni. Did it happen to you?" "No, but it happened to my sister."
That's good. And he would tell that story.
He'd tell it. And he had more stories that just were sort of, you know, long,
all, yeah, long,
with all the different accents. And he was a great storyteller. Lots of fun.
You know, you used the accent there. Why do you think nowadays we can't do that on TV? I mean, people are uptight about
national origin. They're afraid that you're going to hurt somebody's feelings. I have three darling things that my black cleaning lady used to say. Well, I mean, she said them. They weren't regular sayings, but I think they're just charming, and I sent it to Reader's Digest. They never answered because it has the black connotation, you know?
Yeah. What were the things she said?
Well, we had a bad tornado, you know, in Grand Rapids about 20 years ago, I guess. And she went to visit, to work for, she worked for several of us, and she went to work for my friend, and she said to her, "Sarah, did you go to the basement last night when the tornado was coming?" He says, "No. I figure if the Lord want me, I don't aim to make him go to the basement to get me."
That's good.
Isn't that darling?
That's cute.
It's lovely.
What's another good one?
Well, when she said she had to give a talk at her church, she didn't really read very well, and I don't know what Elner could have written for her, but she asked Elner if she'd write down something for her to give a talk at her church, because she said, "When I stands up, my thoughts sits down." Isn't that colorful?
That's great, yeah.
I think that's
a perfect description of what
absolutely,
happened there,
huh? Absolutely. So I thought those were charming, but
was there a third one?
I don't remember what the third one was. I told that the other day to somebody, and I hadn't thought of it as being one of them, but she was very sweet, very nice.
What do
do you think about this day and age? What do you think about all the violence in the country, things like that? What's changing? What's caused this, do you feel?
Well, I'm a Republican. I mean, that is obvious, but I think that there were several things that caused the, or that have led to the, or partial causes at least, of the violence in the schools, which is where it starts really when they're young. I think that busing has made, well, there's several things wrong with busing. It takes you out of your neighborhood and into a neighborhood where they don't want you or you don't fit. It's destroyed the school spirit. We noticed that in the ring department, in the Terryberry rings. Busing is very expensive. You have to buy the buses and the keep and the pay the, you know, the chauffeur, driver, and the gasoline, and then the children's time is taken riding back and forth instead of playing outdoors and doing the kinds of things that they could do if they were at home or on the school in the school area instead of having to go 30 miles to somewhere other place. I think busing is one of the problems. I think the NEA is one of the major problems.
Why is that?
Because the stated first purpose of the NEA is to get power. And it's the most powerful union in the country. Because they have, every town has a school. It isn't like the automobile business, which is primarily in Detroit. It's every place. It reaches its fingers into everywhere.
Yes, yeah.
And I think the NEA is very much responsible for a lot of the kooky ideas that have come about. And let's see. Well, I think that during the war, the Korean War, I guess it was, a lot of people avoided the draft by becoming teachers who weren't really teachers, wouldn't have been teachers, but it was a good way to get out of being drafted. And so they weren't committed teachers. They were getting a job, staying out of the draft. And I think a lot of the really committed, wonderful teachers aren't teaching. And the others have tenure. I think tenure is a very bad thing.
Yeah.
Have I given you enough reasons?
No, that's very good. Very good. Every one of them is something I hadn't really never thought of. I myself got my teaching degree when NAM was going on, and I could never find a job teaching because
everybody
was trying to get out of the war, and I loved teaching. So I never got to do it, but
well,
I finally did.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a very good point. You had a lot of folks that are still in it that aren't dedicated teachers.
Because they have tenure and they get more and more pay. And I don't think you can, you know, the old really dedicated teachers weren't in it for the pay, and they should have been paid more.
Yeah.
But that wasn't their objective, and power wasn't their objective. But now they run everything.
Well, thank you. No, that was very good, very wise. I had never thought of those things in a group like that. It's very good. Thank you. What's the worst storm that you can remember up here? Was there any particular night that you were,
oh, yeah,
or day that you were very concerned?
Well, we weren't. Yeah, we were concerned. It was, I think it was the first summer we were here, or the second. It was very early, and I had a friend from Rockford College, which is where I went to school, who sent a message that she was coming to visit. I'd always just said, come anytime you can. But we didn't have a phone, you see. So she sent the message to the caretaker, and we got the message about 6 o'clock at night. She was coming in on the bus from Rockford, Illinois, at something like 6:45 in Muskegon. And the message had been delayed.
They're handed down.
Down, you know, all the way down. And just at that point, this terrific storm broke, and there was lightning and thunder. And the water was coming in, you know, our the way our bedrooms are across the front. There was water coming in under every door. We all had towels. Our maid, which we still had in the summers, was in one room getting bath towels and wringing them out. Terry was in one room, and I was in one room, and there was a room left over with nobody in it. And I kept thinking, why doesn't somebody come and help me? And I didn't realize we were all doing the same thing.
Yeah.
And the storm was so bad, and it lasted so long that, of course, I didn't get to Muskegon.
Yeah.
After a while, it did subside, and we didn't know exactly what to do. The kids were little, and we didn't want to take them into Muskegon at that hour. And I didn't want to go alone, and I didn't want Terry to go and leave me. So we decided I would go with the maid, and he would stay here with the children. So I got to Muskegon, and I went to the bus stop, and of course the bus had long since vanished, but it was right near the hotel, which has been destroyed, you know, now. So I went there, and I found she had registered and had gone to bed.
Did you ring her up then?
Yep, I got her up and brought her home, but that's a storm I'll never forget. And when I came back, the electricity had gone off, and there were candles. He had lighted every candle that we owned, and it looked so interesting.
It must have been beautiful, yeah.
It really was, and the storm had gone, and of course there was water every place, but
just driving rain and forced
it
in.
It was like the other night, only it lasted longer and more water.
And that was what year, approximately, 1948,
49, 50? Oh, gosh, it was probably 45 or 6.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any memories of the arcade?
A little.
Anything?
One thing I remember was that Rachel and I would go down to the drugstore and get a hot fudge sundae, and John, who was about 10 years younger, would always appear from nowhere, from the rafters or something, to get in on the sundaes.
John
Clay.
Oh, John Clay, okay.
Yeah.
He would come in somehow. And
he was always around. He couldn't get away with a thing. He's the one that took us sailing, too.
Sailing,
you know. That was a few years later.
Didn't tell him to come up to the high side. Do you have any memories of the Silver Beach Hotel, anything?
Yeah, well, just a little, and it probably wouldn't be funny to you, but we went to dinner there, I know, one night when Joey was, it was probably that first summer, she was 2, and they had a big dining room, and they put us right in the middle, which was probably not the right place for a 2-year-old and a 6-year-old. And she was learning to use a spoon, and she put the beans on the spoon, and then she'd come up, and of course, she didn't tilt the spoon this way, she just came up this way, and the beans would be here. So she'd put them back on the plate and on the spoon, and after about the fourth try, she got the beans on the spoon, and she got them up to here, and she, like that, and everybody applauded. So that's my most vivid remembrance.
That's a riot. The whole place breaks into applause and the child finally gets the bean in. That's good.
Well, you know, I hadn't thought about the fact when you have a spoon, you have to keep it
level.
But I mean, I thought about it probably. I mean, I did it, but you don't think about it.
Yeah. And when you're young, trying to learn all those
dexterity little
tricks.
Yeah, that's.
Took enough time for folks to see it.
Yeah, she really put on a good show.
Do you have any memories of the yacht club that you'd like to share? Do you have any? Did you used to go to the dances there?
Oh, yeah.
Paris Ball?
The first remembrance I have of your grandfather, I guess, Clarence, wasn't he your grandfather?
Clarence, yeah.
I went over to the drugstore and I ordered, well, I think Bill Hodgson was going to be the Commodore that summer, and we didn't know anything about that, but I thought he would probably like a really fancy yachting hat. I was wrong, I guess, but anyway, I ordered one, and I gave him my name, and your grandfather said, oh yes, and how is your father? And I said, my father? He thought Terry was my, he didn't know Terry, he didn't know us, but he assumed that I wasn't Mrs. Terryberry, that he was my father.
Oh.
But then we were in charge of the dances for a long time, of the social, I don't know, seemed like a long time, every dance. We were at the bottom of the stairs and we had to keep anybody from taking any liquor upstairs. And we also had to see that every man had on a jacket and a tie.
Wow, this was
that's different.
40s and 50s, probably.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember anything that happened, any experiences at the yacht club?
Well, they had dancing lessons there that we took, and we were, do you remember?
Square dancing on Wednesday night, I remember.
Oh, well, before that, though, we went to Arizona every winter for a month, and the first year we went, was the year Joey was 5, and that was the year we had the, let's see, was she 5? No, it was the, well, it was the year she was 5, but it was not the summer we were here. No, that, she was 2 when we were here. Anyway, we were in charge of the activities for the beach by the time she was 5. And we'd gone to Arizona that winter, and we'd all learned to square dance. And our girls were so crazy about square dancing. At the ranch we went to, the owners were darling people, and they loved the kids, and the kids loved them, and the kids did the square dancing too, and they loved it so. And they made a deal with the owner that if they didn't have square dancing at least every other night, he'd get 10 swats. he told us this. And so, anyway, they had it every other night then, and we came home, we really knew how to square dance pretty well. And so did the kids. So we thought it'd be nice to have a square dance. So we had it on Friday nights, every Friday night, down at the WAB Club. And Joey and Marianne helped teach it. Here's this 5-year-old teaching all these grown-ups how to square dance. And we did that for about 4 summers, or 5 maybe. And that's how everybody on the beach here knew how to square dance. But then the yacht club started it, and they had it on Wednesday, which sort of killed it because there weren't any men home on Wednesday.
That's true, yeah.
And it was, I mean, it killed it for the adults.
Right.
So it was just a children's thing then. But we'd had it on Fridays, and of course there were some men who hadn't gotten here, but most of them were around.
That's fascinating. Do you remember any Pirates balls that you went to that were special?
I only remember one. Well, I mean, I've gone to a lot of them, but I went as an Indian maid. I had a black wig with long braids, and I wore my council fire dress, which you don't know anything about.
No, but
campfire.
I think you must have done this in my lifetime because I think I can remember you.
Yeah, I've done it recent. Well, I wore it in the Jinx, didn't I? With when Bob Goss and I did that reprise.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's a dress. When you're in a campfire, you win honors for various things, and when you reach a certain point, you can buy a dress and put it together and you attach the honors to it. Every bead means something that you've done, and there are leather honors, and you get them at camp and also in campfire. So I wore mine. It used to be forbidden to wear them, but I think that no longer held true then. But I wore mine and with a black wig, and Terry wore an Indian blanket and a headdress, and we painted his face was red and white, and he had bare feet. And Edie Goodspeed's brother Bud Crampton was a boatman, and he wore a white or a straw hat, and he had an oar, and he'd go around and try to get Terry's bare feet in the march around. So that's the one Terry remembers. He had to be very lively.
That's good.
Nobody knew who I was, but then when they saw Terry, they knew who he was because that wig changed my look so much.
Yeah, I swear I can remember you, and that's probably the jinx.
It was not too long ago, 5 years or so.
What was the biggest wedding that you remember around here? The one that you most remember, not necessarily the biggest.
Well, we're sort of graduated from the wedding business now, but we went to a lot of them. Jen's Bogart had one up on the lawn there, where between the McFaddens and Jane Pelton's cottage. And that was very nice. Marianne, of course, was in it, and all the Bogart girls.
Okay, but no wedding nothing in particular you can remember, any wedding that was?
Well, no, not really. I think most of our good friends were married somewhere else.
What if you had to describe the magic of Sylvan Beach and White Lake, what would you say about it? What would be the magic?
Well, I compare it to the place where our neighbors across the street have a very lovely home down on Lake Michigan, much closer than ours, and very nice. But there are no activities at all. They have, I guess, 4 or 5 cottages where they get together and do things. But you know, what we have is something very special. Because we have the beach, we have the yacht club, we have the golf course, and the town is not too far away. And then we have all the special things. And since the new WAB club has been built, we have even more things. And I think we have, that's almost all the social life you need if you play tennis and golf.
About to say the tennis courts, they have another dimension to it.
Right. Yeah. And we've always, Joey said one time when she was little, somebody said, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" And she said, "I want to be a tennis professional tennis player." And she was about 10, and we said, "Well, honey, that's very interesting." Because in those days, I don't think she'd ever seen a professional tennis player. I mean, they didn't have it on television. We didn't have television much. And we said, "Well, how'd you happen to decide on that?" Well, she said, "I want to be like you and Daddy, because every time you come down to the courts, they say, 'Here come the professionals.'" Because nobody played tennis much, you see. And we played, and we'd try to get somebody to play, and we always wore white. I suppose that made us a professional. But now the professionals don't wear it. I wish some of them did. But we laughed because that was why.
Okay. When you came to White Lake, what was the first thing you did when you came to Sylvan Beach? Did you go to the lake to swim? Did you go look at the channel? What was kind of like your little child thing that was in you?
Our little child thing?
Yeah.
We weren't children.
No, but that's still part of you.
I remember when we rented next door, we just put our things down and then we'd go and walk up to the channel and back. And the Macabs had bought a cottage just a year or so before we did, and we stopped to see them, and he was down inside of a cupboard painting it. And we said, after we left, "Aren't you glad we don't own a cottage?"
Yeah, a lot to be said for that.
Yeah. So that, we used to do that quite frequently, the first thing, but later we were doing the same thing, painting little things, and Terry was gardening, and we didn't get away right off the bat. But we were always here. The minute school let out, we'd pick up the kids' report cards at school and come right on up. And we'd be here about a week or 10 days before the post came. And Bess Post had a wonderful sense of humor. But she would be here, maybe they'd get here 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and at dinner time she'd tell me all the beach news, which I hadn't known. I hadn't left the premises, and she'd done the...
She'd already informed me of everything.
So I guess everybody has different aspects.
Well, I want to thank you very much for your time today.
I told you a lot of stuff that's probably not very fascinating.
No, I think it is. I think it's all very important.
Oh, important. Well,
it's fascinating. Fun. Well, you know, who knows in 25 years what somebody's going to think is important. And I think it's our personal glimpses sometimes of life that are the most important. You know.
Well, they were personal, all right.
Well, I thank you very much, and again, if there's something you want to add, feel free to call me. I keep this tape separate with your name on it. If there's something you want to change, please feel free to call me.
Well, there may be some things that you want to change, but I don't know. I just talked.
Okay, and if you think of something that you want to add, don't feel bad about calling me, and I can come back and take it.
Well, you've added probably more than you wanted.
No, I tell you, I...